Cars are a big part of American culture. They're as different as the people who make up our country. And when it comes to choosing a car, the options are pretty much limitless. But cars aren't the only thing we have unlimited choice in.
Americans have incredible choice in the electronic devices that they use. They have incredible choice in the clothes that they wear. They have incredible choice of the restaurants that they go to. Incredible choice in grocery stores. Incredible choice in religious denominations that they want to practice. But in the United States, for most of the last 100 years, Americans have had no fuel choice.
When it comes to one of our most important needs, oil, our lack of choice has serious consequences. This monopoly on our fuel supply is hurting us much worse than we realize. This is the story of oil and how we can finally break the monopoly and end our oil addiction. When oil was first discovered, it was refined into kerosene for lamps. It was used for illumination, not transportation. A young Cleveland businessman saw great potential. He realized that drilling for oil was risky, but refining oil was steady money, so he built his first refinery. His name was John D. Rockefeller. His company became known as Standard Oil. By 1880, Rockefeller controlled over 90% of the U.S. oil business. Standard Oil became a monopoly that charged exorbitant prices. And eventually, the public got fed up. They demanded that President Theodore Roosevelt take action. He announced antitrust indictments against Standard Oil, and in 1911, the U.S. Supreme Court found the Standard Oil Company guilty of monopolizing the fuel market. The ruling splintered it into 34 powerful independent oil companies. And Rockefeller, who had stock in all the newly formed oil companies, became the richest man of the modern age. Much has changed since the breakup of the Standard Oil monopoly, but much remains the same. Americans still have no choice in fuel, and the companies that supply that fuel have immense power over our lives.
When I was president of Shell Oil Company, I would often get asked the question, how do you live in your skin? The American people don't like oil companies, and they don't like the executives who run oil companies who they don't even know. In a public that so relies upon transportation as a way of life, the main suppliers of that transportation, meaning the oil companies, are really not favored at all. There's a hostility that exists between oil companies and consumers. I can remember one of the senators looking over his glasses at me and questioning how I slept at night, whether I had any moral fiber in my body for the extortionate prices that I was charging his constituents. First time, first question to me on Meet the Press. Do you know how much people in this country hate you? Crude oil comes in train car loads or it comes in a pipeline. You cook that oil and you cook it under pressure, like you would cook food in a pressure cooker. As that oil cooks in a refinery, what's in that crude oil barrel separates, then it goes into the gasoline stage.
There's no doubt this will be called the oil age. We really never stop to think about it, but this entire civilization is made out of and moved by crude oil.
Oil is everywhere in our lives. We know it's in our vehicles. We're used to using it to fill up the tank. Oil is in medicines. Oil lubricates almost everything that moves in our economy. Oil is in our clothes. Oil is in the rug you're standing on or in the material of the chair you're sitting in. It's in every piece of plastic that's made.
We live in a society in which we rely upon personal mobility as the primary means of transportation. And there's no public transportation system to rely upon in the United States of America as an alternative to high prices or shortages.
America wasn't always without transportation choices. Once upon a time, we had the best and cheapest public transportation in the world.
The new streamlined streetcars at Los Angeles. The latest in big town transportation on rails.
People loved the trolleys. They could hop off, they could hop on. All the trolleys ran on electricity. It was said that you could go from San Diego to New York City on a trolley just by transferring. Standard Oil, Mack Truck, Firestone, Phillips Petroleum, and General Motors all got together to create a secret company. They would buy up all the trolley systems. They would buy them in Galesburg, Illinois, in Baltimore, in Florida, in Los Angeles. The rails were pulled up. The trolley cars themselves were burned in public bonfires, and they replaced them with smelly, oil-consuming motor buses. Eventually, the federal government discovered that this was a conspiracy to subvert mass transit. All five corporations were indicted. They were tried. They were found guilty. A corporate conspiracy was responsible for destroying the trolleys in America.
With cheap public electric transportation eliminated by oil and car companies, the vision of America's future switched from rails to roads.
During the 1950s, we introduced the biggest public works project in history, the Interstate Highway System. And so we started to connect the entire country in a massive public works highway system. That allowed us to build out suburbs and create shopping malls and mature the auto age and the consumer society. And that was a big leap forward in growth.
See the USA in your Chevrolet.
Americans love mobility. They just want to go.
Through the USA, America's the greatest land of all.
A large part of America's love affair with cars is that it's freedom. It means you can go where you want, when you want, with who you want.
That all depends upon an affordable level of gasoline, and that's what makes the economy go around.
For six decades, we had this freedom, the world had this freedom, and suddenly in the 1970s, that freedom came to a screeching halt.
Egypt and Syria are at war with Israel today.
In 1973, Egypt and Syria attacked Israel. Out of this ensuing conflict, OPEC seized the opportunity to cut the supply of oil worldwide.
The oil-producing countries of the Arab world decided to use their oil as a political weapon.
The threat was economic. If you don't change your foreign policy, we will cut off your oil supply, and average Americans will not be able to do their basic life activities.
It had devastating effects on the American economy. It caused mass unemployment. There were lines to any job that anybody had to offer.
We would have to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning because this one station for the entire community would run out of gasoline by 8 in the morning.
People could only get 10 gallons. They could only get it every other day. People were angry at not having any power over their life.
Now, I gotta tell you, Americans, when they stand in a gas line, they're not that friendly. One day I'm pulling into the gas station. The guy knows me. And I notice he's got guns on his hips, six shooters on each hip. He said, "I'll fight to the death to protect my gas."
Made such an impact on me that I've spent my entire career thinking about this problem. How do we solve the problem that OPEC, the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, this cartel that was created, how do we get to a place where they can't control the destiny of an average American?
OPEC, the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries at Saudi Arabia, Iran, Venezuela, etc., sit on 78% of conventional oil reserves. So we're facing a situation in which this market, the oil market, is dominated by a cartel. Now, at the same time, our cars can only use oil.
After the shock of the oil crisis, instead of building efficient cars and diversifying fuel types, America chose a different path. It increased the number of countries it imports oil from. And like someone protecting their gas station, America built military bases near almost every major oil installation in the Middle East.
America pays about $500 billion a year to maintain military forces whose primary mission is intervention in the Persian Gulf. That expenditure is about 10 times what we pay to buy oil from the Persian Gulf. Of course, we have other interests in the region. It's not all about oil, but it's hard to believe that we would have fought a couple of wars there and sent lots of troops there if Kuwait just grew broccoli.
If we could get away from sending our sailors and airmen and soldiers to go defend somebody else's oil fields, you can't even put a price tag on that. There are some people who naively say, well, no, those forces are there to defend democracy. But if that was really true, then we would be every place where there is a problem. And we're not every place where there is a problem. We are only those places where there is a oil problem.
And while America's oil problem seems big today, it's about to get much worse. America is no longer the only country with an unquenchable thirst for oil. And as global demand for oil skyrockets, so will the price.
I was here in 86. The very first morning I was in China, I saw a sea of thousands of bicycles. 7 o'clock in the morning, making their way down the main avenue, no cars.
Once it became clear that the Chinese were going to build a consumer society, China's production of automobiles just shoots into the stratosphere.
At the end of 2009, GM sold more cars here in China than it did in the United States. That was a real psychological wake-up call for General Motors. Bicycles are off the road, and it's been replaced with the world's largest car market. In 2000, China sold less than 1 million cars. This year, the number will be over 15 million. The most brands sold in any country in the world by far. Nothing like it in the history of humanity have we seen such an explosion in demand for cars. This thing is going to run for decades.
We've never, ever seen anything like this before, because the Chinese have gone through this extraordinary rapid growth. Over 300 million have gone from abject poverty to being reasonably well off. That is the total population of the United States. And they've done it in, 30 years.
Chang Ling is a new parent. She purchased a ticket to compete with 26,000 other Chinese people just to buy a license plate. This is the first step in the long process of buying a car in Shanghai, China.
The number of cars and trucks in China is increasing dramatically. There's 7 cities in China now where they have limits on the ownership of vehicles because they're such large pollution sources.
The Chinese population, as their living standards rise, they are getting more and more concerned about the air that they're breathing, the water that they're using.
People are really worried about the air quality. In January in Beijing, you felt like you could chew the air. You couldn't even see across the street.
In some cities, you have to bid to buy
a license for a vehicle, and it's about $10,000 to $15,000 to just be able to register a car.
The auction will last for exactly 90 minutes. Chang Ling will have the opportunity to bid only twice. China's one-child policy created a higher ratio of men to women. As a result, young women have a higher status, and they want cars.
It's become accepted that when a young man and woman are dating, the woman will say, I'm thinking about getting married to you. Do you have an apartment already? And what kind of car do you drive?
Every Saturday, marriage markets happen in cities across China. Parents hustle to try to match their sons and daughters. And those daughters prefer young men with cars.
The first one is a promising job, and the second is a good house to live, and the third one is a car.
Someone nicknamed BMW as Be My Wife.
So you've got a young population. If they're making around $10,000 a year, they start to think about buying a car.
That car really represents an important symbol of success in China today because it's part of that new Chinese dream.
China will soon have more cars than the United States. In fact, the desire for new cars is so strong, Chinese people are willing to do whatever it takes to get into the driver's seat. If China continues to follow in America's footsteps, the only limit to its growth may be the global oil supply.
The Chinese are going to great efforts to secure future supplies of oil.
China's scouring the world for sources of oil, not just for today, but for the next 10 and 20 years. Now, even though they're making these investments, they're saying, according to our projections, that's still not enough.
If we reach a point where oil becomes scarce, or maybe not as plentiful, and we're all competing for that oil, then the people who get the oil out of the ground are going to be willing to sell it to whoever is willing to pay the most for that oil. Right now, China sits on the largest cash hoard of any country in the world. The current system is not sustainable. It works for now. Everybody gets oil now. But what about the future? How's it going to work when the supplies aren't as great as they are now?
We're going to see the world run out of oil before we run out of Chinese people ready to buy their next car. Where are we going to get the oil?
With hundreds of millions of cars hitting the road in China, there's unprecedented competition for oil, driving the price at America's pumps even higher. So if our foreign supplies of oil aren't enough, why don't we just produce more at home? In the Bakken oil field, the largest shale oil field in North America, they're drilling as much as they can.
In 1951, we first discovered oil in North Dakota. The problem they ran into is while there was a lot of oil, it was very, very dense shale rock. Geologists have known that shale rock holds a lot of oil for a long, long time. We just didn't have the technologies to be able to release it. Just in the last few years, we've come up with techniques that are very effective.
If you have your gas or oil trapped in isolated little pores, you have to fracture the rock in order to create channels for this to flow. This is done by pumping mixtures of water and sand and various other things down into the formations, which then cracks the rock, and that's called hydrofracturing.
The process is also known as fracking. Fracking is a new and under-regulated drilling technology, and there are concerns about its effect on our water and environment.
If you're going to produce oil or natural gas, it's an extractive industry. That means you're digging holes in the ground. Some people don't like that. They don't like the idea of going a mile under the earth. They worry about the effect on the water table. I don't like the fact that it's a dirty fuel.
As the environmental debate continues, fracking shale is still growing at a record pace.
The Bakken is the size of a small state. And we find when we drill these wells, we just don't miss. Every well we drill is a good well. We've moved from being the number 9 producer in oil in the country to number 2.
We're going down to 10,500 some feet. That's where the oil is. Typical wells around here produce anywhere from 400 to 800 barrels per day of oil. Chasing the almighty dollar, the American dream.
In the year 2000, we were drilling about 5,000 wells per year. And with higher price of oil and new technology, we're now drilling 25,000 wells per year.
The most productive time of an oil field is when it's brand new, because it shrinks from then on. It declines. And so you have to keep finding more and more and more.
In the United States, we represent a very small portion of the global population, something like 4 or 5%. But we use 20% of the oil in the world.
In the U.S., we produce less than 8 million barrels of oil a day, in a country that needs about 18 million barrels a day, in a world that needs about 88 million barrels of oil a day. So we're not the big swinger when it comes to the production of oil.
As a result of fracking and other technologies, U.S. oil production has increased. But with today's high prices at the pump, where's the benefit to American drivers?
At a Senate hearing today on the price spike, a troubling prediction from AAA.
The days of a national pump price below $3 is likely a thing of the past.
Which had lawmakers asking how that's possible with all this oil right in our backyard.
We're not producing 5 times as much oil from 5 times as many wells. We're drilling wells that are more expensive. We're drilling more of them. Essentially, we have to run as fast as we can just to stay in the same place.
If we rely upon our own domestic production of crude oil to try to produce enough, we'll die trying. We can't do it.
In 2008, a lot of important firsts happened. China hosted the Olympics for the first time. The first private spacecraft was launched into orbit. The first African-American president was elected. And on July 11th of that year, there was another important first. The price of oil hit $147 a barrel, the highest price the world has ever seen.
When oil began to go over about $80 a barrel in 2007, we saw something very interesting happening. All the other prices for all the other goods and services started to go up.
Most of the people who follow the price of oil for a living say it's headed for $100 a barrel and quickly, as early as tomorrow, and that will be very bad for virtually every facet of American life.
When oil hit about $122, $123 a barrel in early 2008, we had food riots, you recall, in 22 countries.
Let's take a look at the oil market itself. Today, the price, as we told you, we'll tell you again before this show's over, $132 a barrel.
When oil hit $147 a barrel in July of 2008, all the prices across the supply chain for everything we buy went through the roof. And in that month, July 2008, purchasing power shut down all over the world.
It seems that everything is costing more.
Food costs expected to rise 4% this year.
And since everything you buy in a store gets there in a truck powered by diesel fuel, you'll probably pay more for things at the store because of that.
Half of America makes less than $50,000 a year for their families. When oil prices rise, their pocketbooks are constrained almost instantly.
You gotta choose. Do you wanna go rent movies or go to the movies with your kids, or do you wanna, you know, buy gas and be able to make it to work? So it gets rough.
A lot of people, you know, have to choose between medicine and groceries and gas, you know, so it hurts.
Es imposible para mí, para mi familia, llenar mi tanque.
Whatever happens to the price of oil, it has a dramatic impact on every American that has a car, on every business that needs fuel. It ripples through our economy.
Just 60 days after oil hit $147 a barrel, there was another first. For the first time in history, the stock market fell a record 777 points in a single day.
The worst day on Wall Street.
The market fell as if down a well.
We're down over 16%.
Because we're now down 43%.
The Dow traders are standing there watching in amazement, and I don't blame them.
We have hit an end game for the era of crude oil. And that was July 2008 at $147 a barrel. And that was the economic earthquake. The collapse of the financial market 60 days later, that was the aftershock. And so every time we try to regrow the global economy at the same rate we were growing before July 2008, oil prices will go up, all the other prices for everything we buy will go up, and it'll shut down over and over again.
So here's a chart of the S&P 500 tracking along with gas prices, you can see there. Now here's the thing. In the past four instances when gas prices have actually exceeded $4 a gallon, that is when it really starts to hit the consumer's wallet. And look, historically, you can see that the S&P has pulled back as well.
Going back 30 or 40 years, every time the price of oil has made a dramatic movement, it has been followed by a recession in the United States, without an exception.
I've prepared a graph, and it traces the U.S. unemployment rate and the price of oil adjusted for inflation from 1970 to today. And you can see the two graphs go like this. Every time the price of oil goes up, a few months later, unemployment soars.
So we have this catch-22. When the oil price is low, that stimulates economic activity. That creates more demand for oil. As demand increases, price of oil goes up. And the next thing you know, we have a financial crisis, and we start the cycle again.
Every 4 or 5 years, we're in these cycles of growth, slowdown, growth, slowdown. That's the end game.
With gasoline so expensive and the economy in crisis, consumers stopped buying big American cars and switched to smaller models.
And going back to the oil crisis, all of the big three were interested in making big vehicles, except people didn't want to buy them. They wanted to buy cars that were fuel efficient.
By June of 2009, General Motors filed for bankruptcy.
General Motors, the Detroit stalwart, once the world's largest corporation, died today. It was 100 years old.
4 years after the collapse of GM, the city where our love affair with the car began went bust.
Individuals go bankrupt, businesses do it too all the time, but entire cities?
This is enormous. This is the largest municipality ever in the history of this country to file for bankruptcy.
As a kid growing up in Detroit, the world consisted of the big three, GM, Ford, and Chrysler, the center of all things cars, all powerful, all rich. That was it. There's no need to look anywhere else. It was hard to imagine anything but the big three were in charge. I grew up in a city with big, beautiful homes, sprawling front lawns, beautiful tree-lined streets, I go back to Detroit today, and it's a sad, sad story. All those beautiful homes wiped out, boarded up, burned out, torn down, empty lots.
I bring people from overseas, whether it's from Europe or Asia here, and they say, was there a war here? What happened? Now, these used to be bustling, thriving communities. Look at it now.
There's a lot of despair in the city of Detroit. I think the hope of the average person for a better life has disappeared. And the 2008 economic crisis exacerbated every economic problem that the city had to the point of no return. I find it ironic that the industry that built Detroit is the same industry that destroyed Detroit. We all have to scratch our heads at the decisions that they made.
Detroit went bust for numerous reasons. But nobody can deny that a city so singularly dependent on big cars and the cheap fuel to run them was destined to fail.
I really hope the rest of America stands up and takes note. This is real. And if you don't watch it, it can happen in your backyard too.
He can hear the clock ticking. The prices are higher, the supplies are running out, and what we've got to come to grips with is that it's the end of the oil age. This is the sunset.
And that means it's not coming back. It's over. It's absolutely over. I have no doubt about that.
There's an entire army of people who have been trying to shout from the sidelines and get our country and our policymakers to adopt an intelligent solution to our problem. It hasn't happened. We've got war. We've got environmental crisis. We've got climate change. We've got political instability. We've been weakened as a nation. Our pockets have been robbed. $1 billion a day is leaving from our coffers and going overseas. There is no sense to any of this. Until we have a moment of truth with ourselves and our own policymakers, this country is destined and condemned to not only be addicted to oil, but addicted to all the terrible trappings that come with oil. Where there's a will, there will be a way. There is no will. Until that moment comes, there will be no way.
The truth is, we've become dependent on our most important single resource. And the people who control that resource control us. They have us just where they want us. The oil monopoly's dominance over our lives is so firmly entrenched that it's hard to imagine any other way. But there is a way. The way to break up a monopoly is with competition. And competition can only happen when people can make choices. What if one of our choices could be to use a car that doesn't use any oil at all? In the early days of the automobile industry, automakers were experimenting to find the technology that would best power the horseless carriage. And their first choice was a motor powered by an amazing new source of energy, electricity. But the battery technology of the day limited the range, and the cars were prohibitively expensive. When World War I broke out, it was decided the war machines would be powered by internal combustion engines, fueled by gasoline. But the dream of the electric car refused to die. a brilliant scientist who worked in Thomas Edison's lab, quit to develop his own ideas. He would go on to invent radio, X-rays, fluorescent lights, remote control, wireless communication, lasers, and robotics. But perhaps his most important invention was a revolutionary electric motor. His name was Nikola Tesla. Elon Musk made shopping on the internet a reality with his company, PayPal. His more recent ventures include a space company and the creation of an electric luxury car.
When I was like about 12 or 13, I learned that you could be an inventor. And I was reading about people like Nikola Tesla and Thomas Edison. So I thought, well, if I could invent things that people found useful, that would be a great thing to do. What we're really showing with the Model S is that it's possible to create a compelling electric car that's aesthetically appealing, has long range, good performance, and that competes with the best of the premium gasoline cars. That was something that the industry did not believe was possible.
Jean-Paul DeJoria is the owner of a hair care line and a famous tequila brand. He's also the owner of a solar panel installation.
These are the panels that help create the energy to power the Tesla. From the sun to the car.
Isn't that amazing?
Back in 1987, my partner and I built one of the first solar energy cars to race across Australia. And we knew one day in the future, by gosh, this technology is gonna go, and it has.
What kind of an engine runs this? There isn't any engine. This is a space for luggage. Around back, the trunk is for luggage. So you have all this extra space. Well, they really thought this one out. Electric cars are here.
The success of the Tesla S prompted other car makers to roll a fleet of new electric cars onto America's roads. The lowest price model is under $20,000. Almost all of the electrics have at least a 100-mile range, and their batteries are generally guaranteed for 100,000 miles.
What you're getting with an electric vehicle is a huge savings on a monthly basis because you're avoiding the pump and you're paying the equivalent of a dollar a gallon gasoline. The biggest part of the cost for an electric vehicle is the battery. Right now, the battery of choice is lithium ion. It's the same kind of technology that's in your laptops and your cell phones. And that means the manufacturers learn. They learn how to make these batteries cheaper. In the next 7 years, we'll see battery prices probably cut in half.
In 10 years, maybe a little less than 10 years, there will be long-range, compelling, affordable electric cars for all price ranges. In the future, I think there will be no gas stations. People will all have electric cars. They will charge the cars primarily at home and sometimes at work. And for long distance travel, there will be fast charge stations where you can charge your car very rapidly and conveniently. Probably the biggest value that Tesla will have on the automotive industry is not the cars we make ourselves, but what we convince the industry can be done.
Despite the potential of EVs to be powered by renewable energy, most of today's electricity comes from natural gas, coal, and nuclear.
The only way to have solar and wind be effective as a supply source is if you have an electric car, because we don't use oil to generate electricity in this country. And right now in this country, we have 100 or 120,000 electric vehicles, and we have 250 million liquid fuel vehicles. The time it will take us before everyone in the United States switches over to driving an electric vehicle. When's the next time that you, the viewers of this movie, are going to buy a new car?
So when I describe the future of what's after the internal combustion engine, people say, how long will it take? I think it'll take 3 to 4 decades.
Eventually, most of our cars will be run by electric motors. But what about the hundreds of millions of internal combustion engines on the road right now? How can a country drastically reduce its need for oil in the world we live in today. Well, kind of like this. Brazil is booming. Part of the reason it's booming is because at every pump in Brazil, people have a choice.
What we have today is a carryover from the 70s, and it's the solution.
In 75, on the first oil crisis, we decided to replace oil by biofuels. We imported 90% of our oil at that time.
It was decided that every service station had to have an ethanol pump.
With almost the same physical size as the United States, Brazil is the most successful gasoline replacement program in the world. To make such a bold change required a bold leader. Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva grew up poor and became an activist fighting for the rights of workers. He ran three times unsuccessfully before becoming president of Brazil in 2002.
Lula da Silva has been elected president of Brazil with the largest margin of victory in the country's history. Mr. da Silva is the first working class president in the country's history.
He served two terms as president and left office as popular as a rock star. Under his leadership, Brazil's economy grew by the trillions. All foreign debts were repaid, and millions of people who had been starving were now fed. But perhaps the biggest achievement of Lula's administration was something no other country has done: complete and total independence from foreign oil.
Você fica assim conversando com ele.
Mas aí o senhor vai ficar ouvindo a minha tradução. Muito chato, o senhor vai ter que falar da minha voz.
É?
Melhor tirar e...
Que tínhamos capacidade de produzir e que tínhamos capacidade de ter um combustível menos poluente. Começou-se a produzir no Brasil, então, um carro flexível.
With the choice of fuel now at every pump, the next task was to create a car that could take advantage of that. Enter the flex fuel car.
Um carro flexível, que você pode utilizar 100% de gasolina, 100% de etanol, 50%, 50%, a mistura que você quiser fazer, e o carro funciona adequadamente.
If you take a car, gasoline car, to make it a flex car, that means it can take 100% ethanol, costs per vehicle no more than $150. That's how much it costs.
Uma pequena adaptação no módulo, e aí com isso o carro consegue funcionar normalmente.
And sure enough, they hit a nerve. The consumer loves it.
People in Brazil used to say, if I can have the option of choosing the fuel, why not?
Here we have a permanent competition between ethanol and gasoline in all gas stations, which is very good for the consumer.
Hoje eu abasteci com álcool e dou preferência a abastecer com álcool.
Para mim ele é mais econômico e um carro que anda bem, é durável, é. Tô satisfeito.
Além de ser mais barato, a gente tem uma produção muito, muito forte no Brasil.
Ethanol is alcohol that's made by fermenting sugars. Ethanol can be made from a wide variety of substances, but in Brazil, they use a crop they've been growing for 500 years.
The food versus fuel debate really doesn't work in Brazil because there's nothing being displaced in order to make ethanol. You're talking about millions of hectares that are not planted with anything. The fact that you're planting sugarcane to make ethanol is not displacing any food production.
Brazil's choice of ethanol as an alternative not only fueled their cars, it fueled their economy.
Well, there's no question about the importance of ethanol economically. The cane industry employs 8 times more jobs than the oil industry creates in Brazil.
Em 8 anos aqui no Brasil, Nós levamos 40 milhões de brasileiros para a classe média.
Sugarcane works in Brazil, but every place can have its own unique solution.
Nós precisamos investir em combustível, sabe, alternativo, de primeira, de segunda geração, de terceira geração. O mundo precisa disso.
With strong leadership and political will, Brazil, a country much like the United States, achieved what people thought was impossible. A choice at the pump. And with that, they broke a monopoly.
Eu sou um sonhador. Eu acredito que nós vamos conquistar, sabe, que o mundo aprenda a viver sem o petróleo.
What's stopping America from doing the same thing? When Henry Ford decided to use an internal combustion engine in his automobile, his fuel of choice was alcohol. Ford grew up on a farm and knew that every farm had the ability to create alcohol from a variety of material. He called alcohol the fuel of the future. He designed all of his cars to be fuel flexible, so people could choose either gasoline or alcohol. Rockefeller saw this as a threat to his oil monopoly and did what he could to stop it. Rockefeller used his power and influence to help pass a constitutional amendment known as Prohibition, which prevented the sale and transportation of all alcohol, including Henry Ford's alcohol fuel.
Ethanol is not just any competitor. It is the better fuel. It has always been the better fuel.
Here's the thing about alcohol. Anyone can make it. I mean, making alcohol is mankind's second oldest profession. We have so many things we can use for making alcohol. We can grow things like beets. We can grow sweet sorghum, agave plant, mesquite, buffalo gourds. What we have here is a very common cactus known as prickly pear. It grows all over the world in huge quantities, especially places where it's dry. We can grow this in poor countries that don't have a viable agriculture in arid areas and provide fuel and food for animals if necessary. Many of you have seen this plant flowering. This is a flower from cattails. These can generate 7 times as much alcohol as corn or prickly pear. So what is the best alcohol crop? It's the one that's best suited to your soil and climate where you are.
In the United States today, alcohol fuel, or ethanol, is distilled at hundreds of refineries all over the country. They produce 15 billion gallons every year. That's 10% of our fuel. In fact, it's probably in your fuel tank right now. But ethanol drives up food prices, right? Well, that's exactly what some people want you to believe. The same industries that fought ethanol 100 years ago are fighting it today. When oil prices increased in 2007 and 2008, it prompted a wave of interest in biofuels and put the oil industry on edge. According to internal emails obtained by Senator Chuck Grassley, a conglomerate of organizations hired the DC-based PR lobbying firm Glover Park Group to come up with a way to discredit the biofuel industry.
This anti-ethanol campaign is not just a coincidence. $300,000, 6-month retainer of a Beltway public relations firm is behind the smear campaign against ethanol.
Their strategy was simple. The cost of food had soared due to the oil price spike, but they would pin the increased food price not on oil, but on biofuels. Their plan worked perfectly.
Turning corn into fuel was widely considered a smart way to reduce U.S. dependence on foreign oil. But now the idea is being challenged because of the worldwide food crisis.
We are burning our food supply.
The anti-ethanol fuel campaign tried to hide this essential fact. The byproduct of the ethanol process is food. Lots of food.
From 2006 to 2012, we had record surpluses every year, and we had 1.5 billion bushels of surplus corn almost every year of that period. It was mountains of it all over the Midwest.
The corn that everybody is so worried about that we're taking out of people's mouths, well, that corn doesn't go to humans anyway. That corn is being grown mostly as animal feed. And one of the best animal feeds is not corn on the cob, but it's distillers grains, which is made from corn. Now, the funny thing is that in order to make distillers grains, you have to go through the fermentation distillation process, which creates ethanol.
When the press says 25% of our grain goes into an alcohol plant, the assumption is it's been destroyed. But what they don't mention is in goes the corn, and out comes ethanol and animal feed.
In order to feed cattle, well, you have to make ethanol. Well, as long as you can make ethanol, you might as well use it for a vehicle.
It's not food versus fuel. It's more food and fuel. If you keep capital in your community, that capital gets used. And suddenly, you're not just energy self-sufficient, you're financially self-sufficient.
We're talking about communities saying, we're going to make our own fuel. We're going to all chip in money and have our own little distillation plant. If we can simply just change the way we make that fuel, the way we buy that fuel, from whom we buy that fuel, there's no longer an economic problem.
There's another alcohol fuel that's so versatile, you can make it just about anywhere. And we mean anywhere. Dr. Robert Zubrin is a scientist working with NASA to find the best fuel to use on missions to Mars. His choice was methanol. Methanol, also known as wood alcohol, is the simplest alcohol you can make. Mars has both water and carbon dioxide, and that's all you need to make methanol.
Methanol is an alcohol. It is a liquid. It looks like water. It's much better than gasoline in terms of air pollution. To give you a sense of how much cleaner methanol is than gasoline, we're going to conduct a little experiment here where we're going to burn the two of them side by side. This is methanol, and as you can see, it's as clear as water. And this is gasoline, which has a slight yellow tinge. Methanol, gasoline. First, let's light the methanol. You can see the methanol is burning right now. This is an extremely clean burning flame. Now let's take a look at gasoline. By comparison to methanol, this is filthy. It's got soot, it's got particulate emissions. That's what you're putting up into the air when you burn gasoline.
And look at the residue. Methanol, there's no residue at all. It's a completely clean burning fuel.
They're also safer than gasoline cars. They're much less likely to catch fire in the event of a crash, which is why race car drivers have preferred methanol for decades.
For almost 100 years, race car teams have competed to win the Pikes Peak climb. The race is a treacherous 12.5-mile ascent with 156 hairpin turns at speeds as high as 200 miles an hour. It's an extremely challenging race, and teams do everything possible to ensure safety, including choosing to run on methanol fuel.
19 years, we've been running methanol. It's just much better fuel for racing.
Barrel of methanol costs you $150. Barrel of race gas is almost $700 now. It costs a third of what race gas does.
If methanol is so great, why isn't it available at the pump? Well, not that long ago, it was. Soon after the oil shocks of the 1970s, America's cities faced another petroleum-related emergency.
Here's a sight not uncommon here in the Southland. Smog as thick as pea soup often envelops our area.
Smog alert warnings lit up the Caltrans signs along LA freeways again today.
As a way to clean up vehicle emissions, California began to test methanol. In 1981, the state government convinced the Ford Motor Company to specially make methanol cars. Volkswagen joined in, producing their own methanol cars. A number of trucks and buses also started running on methanol.
It's a step in the right direction. The idea is to get the technology out in the street, get people using it, and then you can start spreading the technology to more and more vehicles.
I started working on the methanol program in 1979. The California Energy Commission, or CEC, was a motivator for this by working with the oil companies and getting the majors to all participate by putting in methanol-compatible dispensers in their branded fueling stations. It was a shotgun marriage, so to speak. The oil companies at that time, I think, felt that this was a good thing to try. But as soon as they found a way out, they did.
That way out came in 1990, when Congress passed amendments to the Clean Air Act. The federal government decided to require oil companies to clean up their gasoline by adding alcohol fuels like methanol. But instead of blending methanol into their gasoline, Big Oil came up with a different plan. They created reformulated gasoline. Reformulated gasoline contains chemicals that help clean up vehicle emissions, but some of those same chemicals cause cancer.
The oil industry basically said, I have a new gasoline for you that does the same thing as methanol. And by the way, we think that that product will be cheaper than methanol.
In the end, the oil companies won and methanol lost.
There is no competition now at the pump. There would have been that competition had methanol stayed in the marketplace. But we lost that benefit.
The materials that can be used to make methanol are extremely plentiful and cheap. It could be made from anything that either is or was once a plant. It could be made from coal. It could be made from natural gas. Right now, the United States is having a natural gas production boom. We have so much natural gas that we are flaring it so much that you can see it from space.
Today, methanol is primarily made from natural gas.
The question of whether natural gas is going to play a role in this energy transition. There's a lot of burden on this industry to prove that it can be clean. There are clearly ways the industry can improve its practices.
Love it or hate it, natural gas is likely here to stay. According to the Department of Energy, as a result of fracking, production of natural gas in the United States is projected to increase. And by 2020, there could be enough additional natural gas to replace half of our imported fuel with methanol. But there are other ways to make methanol too. In Iceland, there's a facility that turns waste carbon dioxide into methanol fuel. Their carbon recycling system takes CO2 from natural geothermal steam, combines it with hydrogen made from water, and voila, methanol.
When the plant is full capacity, we produce 5 million liters a year.
Carbon Recycling's test program runs a number of cars on M50. A mixture of 50% methanol and 50% gasoline. In the near future, carbon dioxide could be the perfect source for methanol fuel. For now, there's another practical, plentiful, and cheap resource from which to make methanol. At the Oak Ridge National Laboratory, the U.S. government has been studying how much fuel can be made from biomass.
The Oak Ridge study was originally designed to look at how much biofuel we could make in the U.S. using biomass. And what they came up with was 1 billion tons. They did the study twice because people were so shocked by the number at the time. What is biomass? Biomass means ordinary wood, clippings, yard waste, agricultural waste of all types. It can mean municipal solid waste. It can be animal renderings and fats and wastes and greases and oils, all kinds of waste residues.
The United States generates 240 million tons of trash every year, and about 160 million tons of it ends up in landfills. That 160 million tons could be converted in a device like this to 15 to 16 billion gallons of methanol.
There's 1 billion tons of available biomass that can be affordably aggregated for biofuels without affecting other users of biomass. That's about the entire United States gasoline supply, so really there's enough to replace all of it.
1 billion tons of biomass makes about 210 billion gallons of methanol. But to be conservative, let's say we could only convert 50%. That still equals enough fuel to run half of the cars in America. The cost to build methanol refineries, it's about $420 billion. But that's less than 1 year of operations in the Persian Gulf. Now, you can't go as far on a gallon of methanol. So for example, if methanol costs $1.20 per gallon, the relative cost would be about $2 a gallon for a domestically produced fuel that's made from a multitude of sources.
I think they're going to go crazy in Texas. I think they're going to go crazy in Saudi Arabia.
So what kind of cars can use these two monopoly-busting fuels? In the 1980s, methanol cars held promise for cleaning up California's air. There was just one problem. When the cars were too far from a methanol pump, they needed a way to fill up on gasoline. Once again, the Ford Motor Company came up with a solution. Since Ford's early models were all designed to run on multiple fuels, they were well suited to make the first modern version, a flex fuel vehicle that was capable of running on methanol, ethanol, gasoline, or any mixture. Today, there are 9 million modern flex fuel cars on the road. These new flex fuel cars can run on ethanol, gasoline, or any mixture.
This is Blue Diamond. I just bought it because it was small and I figured I would save on gas, but we were looking online and I know there's a couple Ford and Dodge and different cars that also offers the flex fuel too. So our new car, we're gonna stick with the flex fuel.
The United States started building flex fuel cars in 1994. And most people have no idea they've been on the road. The only way you knew you had a flex fuel car is that your gas cap was yellow. There are millions and millions of cars on the road that are flex fuel. And guess what? People who own them have no idea that that's what they are.
But you don't have to have a flex fuel car to run ethanol fuel. With a simple kit, you can convert your car to flex. There's one man who's been installing ethanol fuel kits in just about every vehicle on the road, including this thing. Using technology from Brazil, Alex Conger developed a small computer that allows any normal gasoline car to also accept ethanol fuel.
We've done Lamborghinis, we've done 12-cylinder Mercedes, we've done Porsches. It just doesn't matter what vehicle it is. If I install this kit, it gives that ability to that car to run either ethanol, gasoline, or any combination thereof, similar to what a flex fuel vehicle does.
John is going to do the install. He's never done an install before. Our kit always has been described as the kit that anybody can install. Now that the ground wire is in place, the system is installed and we're ready to fire up this car. Now we're going to add new life to this vehicle by putting some E85 ethanol in it.
The power button, nice and smooth. There's no check engine light.
But what if you don't need a flex fuel car or even a kit? What if the car you drive today already contained technology that could enable it to run on gasoline, ethanol, or methanol? What if the only thing that prevented that from happening was a simple software update of the car's computer?
I've been on the assembly line at Ford. I've gone from the start of the fuel system at the tank all the way to the fuel injectors. There is not a single item that is different between the alcohol version and the non-alcohol version. And at the end of that process, I asked the guy, what's different? We haven't seen any differences so far in parts. He goes, oh, it's the software.
Americans love cars, and they love computers. When they find out that a simple piece of software is what stands between them and a choice at the pump, well, let the hacking games begin.
Change with engine technology over the last 100 years isn't the engine itself and all those metal bits that are rotating, it's software updates. In America right now, we're under the impression that you have to change a ton of parts to make this run off of alcohol fuels. That is not true. The software solutions have been developed already. Every car since 1996 sold in the U.S. has what's called an OBD2 plug. It's somewhere around your knee area in every single vehicle. Well, you plug in a cable to the laptop, you can actually reprogram the car. Now, here's how I discovered that all these cars have flex fuel. Start with engine diagnostics, scroll down to flex fuel. It can either calculate it or it can use an actual sensor. I don't want to add a sensor, I'm just going to have it calculate. So I turned it on, started going for some drives, and then adapted to the fuel. I've been able to test this Cobalt as a flex fuel vehicle on ethanol, gasoline, methanol, and various blends between them.
According to John Brackett, some automakers purposefully write their software so their cars perform worse when running on alcohol fuels.
The performance on the GM flex fuel cars is subpar because they actually retard the timing when they are using alcohol fuels. I have not found a good reason why you would ever retard the timing. I don't think the car companies are going to be the ones that enable flex fuel. I think it's going to be Americans. It's going to be the people that want to change their cars, that want to tune them, that want to customize them. That's the best part about being an American. We don't like it, we'll change it. The information is out there, the technology is out there, the know-how is out there, and the forums are out there to spread this knowledge. We are going to be able to do this on our own.
We already have the technological ability and products to stop using oil right now.
The American manufacturers know how to make these cars, and they're not making them.
I fully believe that we can convert the U.S. fleet to flex fuel with just software updates.
With America's entrepreneurial spirit and the software secret now exposed, it's only a matter of time before the potential of most cars to be fuel flexible is unlocked.
So I personally would like to have a car that could run on more than one fuel. But one of the hardest things about breaking the monopoly is actually not getting the car. The problem is, could you find a station for that fuel? And that is really what it would take to make a transition, because it doesn't matter what car I have, I need the fueling station.
So how does a person find a pump near them that sells alternative fuel? The same way you find everything else today. A quick search online will show the nearest pumps and even link to apps that can be downloaded to a smartphone that can direct you to a station. And one of those stations you might arrive at is this one. Phil and Cheryl's is one of less than 3% of American gas stations that are fighting against the single fuel monopoly. They are big advocates of choice at the pump.
I've been in the gasoline business my whole career. Selling ethanol products at our convenience store is a moral obligation. We feel like we're doing the Lord's work.
And it's actually surprising, a lot of older model cars, you can use E85, even though they're not labeled as flex.
E85 is a mixture of 85% ethanol and 15% gasoline. It's the highest concentration of ethanol sold at pumps in America.
If somebody comes up with an older Tahoe or a Suburban, I go out and I ask them if I can look in their car. And I'll look in their gas cap and it'll say E85 or unleaded. Then I tell them, well, you could use E85. They didn't know that they had any options. They're so excited.
Once they try it, they usually come back and buy it again.
The oil companies invented the pump. They control it, and they've done a pretty good job of enhancing it and creating a pretty good fuel experience over the years. What's going to break the monopoly at the pump is entrepreneurs who build alternative distribution. It's time to build that kind of infrastructure.
We are at a Propel Clean Fuel Point in Redwood City, California. A clean fuel point is a pump that we install on a partner property. In this case, it's a Valero station, and we offer two renewable fuels at that pump. The fact that E85 is a little bit cheaper than gasoline is definitely what initially draws a lot of people in off of the street.
It's much cheaper, and I understand it runs smoother on flex fuel.
What's the gas station of the future going to look like? It's going to look a lot different than today's. And one of the reasons is not just biofuels, but look at natural gas coming along. That's a very inexpensive source of fuel as well.
Todd's is one of a number of businesses that convert vehicles to run on CNG, or compressed natural gas.
I believe in this. I believe in CNG with all my heart. I believe in transforming the United States one vehicle at a time.
But these conversions come with a hefty price tag.
The cost is expensive to get converted. A little bitty tank right there is $2,700. We start out minimum of $5,000.
Using natural gas as a fuel is attractive to high mileage fleets because of its low price and lower tailpipe emissions.
Gasoline costs us $143 to fill my truck up. Okay, on CNG, I can fill up for about $16. That's huge.
I got a 2012 Ford F-250 pickup. I spent about $100 a day in gas. Now I'm spending about $20.
I don't care if I had to pay $250 a gallon for it. If we can get our Army guys from fighting for oil back over here, it'd be well worth it. It's cleaner, it's better, it's abundant right here in America. It's American.
But most gas stations in the United States are under a franchise agreement with one of the big brands. And that can limit what the station owner can do.
The reality is, once that franchise agreement is signed, the major petroleum company controls all decisions based on fuels. and the lack of ability for that individual business owner to make those decisions continues to block out alternative fuels.
Of the 120,000 gas stations in America, almost one-third are independently owned. But independent gas station doesn't just mean small. All those large chain stores with gas stations, yep, they're independent too. So what if they started selling ethanol and methanol?
The service station of the future, the smart ones, are going to see that serving the large number of customers and giving them what they want is the right way to go, rather than trying to force them to use essentially a monopoly fuel.
The pump is where the oil monopoly exerts its power. And by using a combination of electricity, ethanol, methanol, and natural gas, the pump is where America can take that power back.
It's almost unfathomable to me that we won't allow the market to solve this problem. We've dealt with cartels and monopolies before. We know how to do this.
A cartel is a conspiracy against the free market. Adam Smith discusses this, and he makes it very clear that it is entirely appropriate for governments to move to break up cartels.
In 2006, a new piece of legislation was proposed in the House of Representatives Transportation Committee. It was called the Open Fuel Standard. It would unblock methanol fuel and require automakers to make flex fuel cars.
The Open Fuel Standard is a bill that has been repeatedly introduced since around 2006 in various forms.
Which says very simply, all cars built or sold in America will have the flex fuel capability.
Every year, the Open Fuel Standard gets introduced into a committee in the House or Senate. But not once has it left a committee for a vote. Why would legislation that could help free America from oil dependence be blocked? Maybe because members of the committees that have reviewed the Open Fuel Standard have received over $32 million in campaign contributions from Big Oil. But the U.S. government isn't just helping the oil monopoly by not passing laws. It's also instituting regulations that keep the oil monopoly in control. For example, today it's illegal for commercial operations to install flex fuel kits, even though you can install one yourself. And pouring anything into your car not specifically designated by the manufacturer is also technically illegal. Finally, hacking your car? You guessed it, illegal. So whose side is our government really on?
Americans have been hearing about energy independence since 1974, and nothing's been done. The American people need to have fuel choice. And for those who say, no, we don't want to do that, they need to answer the following question. In whose interest is it that the American people do not have fuel choice?
There's been a monopoly on the fuel system of cars built and sold in this country. It's time to break that monopoly. It's time to give Americans choice.
People are starting to realize to make the changes needed, they can't rely on government. They can't rely on corporations. They have to rely on themselves. While oil companies profit from a one-fuel system, the people suffer because of it. And those people are starting to channel their anger into action.
What's important is we need fuel democracy and fuel choice, not fuel monopoly.
We've got to find a path forward that uses fuel more efficiently, that uses fuel that pollutes the atmosphere less, and that uses fuel that we can afford.
After 5 years in a row of rapidly rising crude oil prices carries over into pain at the pump, I think it's a reasonable alternative to have fuels competition. It would enable us to use other than just pure gasoline or pure diesel to power our vehicles so that we can open up the economy and reduce the cost of fuel to Americans.
If the consumer could freely decide to run on either gasoline or an alternative fuel, very quickly gasoline would be forced to compete at the pump. And what this would do is put a permanent constraint on the price of oil. The price of fuel would come down. It would create millions upon millions of jobs. It would lift this enormous tax that is being placed on our economy. It would stop the flow of wealth from the free world to the oil cartel. The benefits would be enormous.
We bailed out the automakers. The one thing we didn't do is give a return on that money to the American taxpayer as a whole by demanding from the automakers to open their cars to fuel competition, as they have said for years that they are willing to do.
Let's do for ourselves what the rest of the world is doing for themselves by opening up choice. If people want fuels from natural gas, people want fuels from biofuels, people want batteries, let people choose what fuels they want to buy. It is as American can be.
Everybody should have the right to choose the future they want. And the choice for a better future begins at the pump.